warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon everyone. I would like to say thank you to all audience here for taking time to listen to our presentation today. It's great to see you all. Let me just start by introducing myself and our team first. I'm Kansa Labiba and our group members here are Clea Resta Lima, Putri Khoirunisa, and Salsabila Ananda, and we are from Group 1. In this opportunity, I would like to present about the concept and practice of welcoming visitors, meeting with client or customers, handling complaint, and performance appraisal. First, we will explain to you about welcoming visitors. We will explain about meeting with client or customers and handling complaint. And the last, we will explain about the performance appraisal. Well, let's start this presentation from Putri. Please coming to Putri.
Thank you for the opportunity. Putri Khoirunisa is here and I'll be bring you to the first chapter. It's welcoming visitor. Imagine that guests are not welcome. What will happen? Our company will get bad impression, right? So, what is welcoming visitor? Welcoming visitor refers to the act of greeting and receiving guests who arrive at a specific location, such as an office, home, or even venue. Boleh di next? Okay. Why welcoming visitor is important? Overall, welcoming visitor is an important aspect of providing a positive and professional experience for guests, establishing relationship, and creating a safe and secure environment. That's why welcoming visitor is important. Right, next. Nah, there are several stages in welcoming visitor. The first stage is greeting and introduction. In this stage, when a visitor arrives, greet them with a warm welcome and introduce yourself. For example, good morning, welcome to our office. My name is Putri Herisa and I'm your secretary here. Don't forget to use formal language when speaking with visitors, such as sir or ma'am, to show respect. The next stage is offer assistance. In this stage, you must ask the visitor if they need any assistance, such as direction to meeting room or restroom facility. Don't forget to inform the visitor of any office procedure. The next stage is escorting the visitor. If the visitor needs to be escorted to a meeting room, introduce them to the person they will be meeting with and ensure they are comfortable before leaving. Or if the visitor is waiting for someone, you need to offer them to a comfortable place to sit and wait. The next stage is business etiquette. There are several business etiquette. First, you must be professional and courteous in all interaction with visitor. Two, you must avoid discussing personal topic or gossiping about colleagues. Three, you need to speak clearly and enunciate your words, especially if the visitor is not fluent in English. The last stage is conclusion. In this stage, you must say thank to the visitor for their visit and offer assistance if they need anything else. In this stage, you also exchange contact information and express interest in future collaboration or partnership. Now, remember, the way you welcome visitors reflect the image of your company. A warm and professional welcome can make a lasting positive impression on visitors and can help establish a strong relationship between your company and potential client or partner. Okay, that's enough for me. Let's go to the next slide with my partner. Thank you.
Okay, the next topic is meeting with client or customer. Next. Step 1 is planning a meeting. Planning a meeting involves a series of activities that are undertaken to ensure that the meeting is productive, efficient, and achieve its intended purpose. Planning a meeting helps to ensure that everyone is on the same page and the meeting stays on the track. It also helps to ensure that all necessary preparations are made, such as booking the venue, arranging for audio and visual equipment, and preparing materials. By planning a meeting, participants are better prepared and can make the most of the time that is allotted. One is purpose and objective of the meeting. it is important to determine the purpose and objective of the meeting beforehand to ensure that everyone is on the same page and the meeting stays on the track. Two is selecting a suitable date, time, and venue. When planning a meeting, it is crucial to choose a date, time, and venue that is convenient for all participants and allows for adequate preparation and travel time. 3. Preparing an agenda. An agenda outlines the topics and issues to be discussed during the meeting. It helps to keep the discussion focused and ensures that all important points are covered. 4. Is sending our invitation and confirmations. Once the date, time, and venue and agenda have been finalized, invitations should be sent out to all the participants. It is also important to confirm attendance beforehand to avoid any last-minute cancellation of or no shows. Step 2 after planning a meeting is preparing for a meeting. Next. Preparing for a meeting involves a series of activities that are undertaken to ensure that participants are adequately prepared and the meeting is productive and efficient. The process typically includes researching the client or customers, preparing presentation materials, and rehearsing and practicing the presentations. First, researching the clients. Researching the client or customers involves gathering information about their needs, preference, and interests. These information can be used to tailor the presentation to their specific needs and interests, which is it can help to increase engagement and improve the overall outcome of the meeting. 2 is preparing presentation materials. Preparing presentation materials involves developing materials such as a PowerPoint presentations, handout, and visual aids. This material should be well organized, so it can be easily to follow and designed to support the presentations and help participants to understand and retain the information being presented. 3 is rehearsing and practicing the presentations. Involves reviewing the materials, practicing the delivery, and anticipating questions or concerns that may arise during the meeting. This helps to ensure that the presentation is polished, confident, and well received by the audience. Next, step 3 is conducting a meeting. Conducting a meeting involves several case activities that are essential for a productive and successful outcome. These activities include, first, opening the meeting. The first step in conducting a meeting is to welcome all attendants and introduce the purpose of the meetings. This helps to set the tone and establish the agenda for the meeting. Second is reviewing the agenda. It is important to review the meeting agenda at the beginning of the meeting to ensure that all participants are on the same page and understand the objectives. Next is presenting information. During the meeting, presenters should share information and provide updates on relevant topics. It's important to use visual aids such as PowerPoint slides to enhance the presentation and ensure that information is conveyed effectively. 4 is facilitating discussions. Encourage active participants and discussions by all participants, allowing everyone to express their experience and share some of the ideas. It is important to manage the discussion to ensure that it stays on topic and remains productive. Next, making decisions. During the meeting, decisions may need to be made on a variety of issues. It is important to listen to all the opinions, weigh the pros and cons, and make informed by the decisions. 6 is assigning action items. At the end of the meeting, it is important to assign action items to attendees to ensure that follow-up tasks are completed. And the last is closing the meeting. Finally, it is important to summarize the decisions we made, review any action items assigned, and thank attendees for their participants. By following those steps, a meeting can be conducted effectively and efficiently, resulting in a positive outcome for all involved. Next
topic is about handling complaints. So, what are customer complaints? Customer complaints are an indicator that something is wrong from your company profile. Sometimes it can be happened from your company, or maybe it's just only an expectation from customer about the goods or service that you give. So that customer are satisfied with what we provide, that we need is a trust and a good relationship between the customer and the companies. And then how to handling a complaint, that it can be useful feedback for the company. The first step is dig deep by asking the right question. Why you have to do that? Why you have to know deeper about the complaints? Does anyone knows why you have to do that? Okay, I will explain it. So, asking the right questions helps you understand the root of the questions or the complaints. Find out if there is a way to resolve the problems and determine if the complaint contains really useful for your company or not. And then if you feel that you cannot solve the problem properly, you can ask someone who can know better or understand for help, so the problem can be resolved quickly and clearly. But don't forget to tell your customer that you need help from your friends. You can say sorry for this problem. It can be resolved quickly with Mr. Adams as our manager, or something else like that. And then step two is identify the type of customer you are dealing with. A study from University of Florida found that when dealing with customer complaints, you are likely to encounter one of the following type of customer. It's motivated by different beliefs, attitudes, and needs. The first type of customer is customer who are not ashamed to tell you are annoying. When you want to respond, avoid imitating their emotions behavior. You must be able to be polite, but also firm, so the customer not at will at you. And then the second type is customer who pay well and demand premium support for it. When responding, avoid excuse and provide immediate solution within the VIP workflow. Same with the other customer, but the steps given are different and more luxury, of course. And then the next type from customer is customer who contact you frequently. If you found this customer, you just stay patient and avoid coming across as frustrated when responding to these customers. When satisfied, they often become repeat customer and advocate to your company. And then a customer who don't want to complain and may just take their business elsewhere without ever letting you know there was a problem. You have actively reach out to these customers to solicit and resolve their complaints. Otherwise, you never hear their feedback. Maybe there are many types of customers, but knowing the different personality types of customers can help you respond to the person being helped and not make the wrong decisions. And then the step three is respond to customers quickly. When it comes to unhappy customers, a speedy response goes from being a nice to have to a necessity. Complaints are best resolved as soon as possible. A customer leaving a feature request won't mind at all if you take a day to respond. But customers who are in emergency situations want a quickly response. Make responding to them a priority. What can be done is create or prepare a spirit folder from the QA so the team can filter message or problem from customer who really need them to those who are not in emergency. And then for the step 4 is present the solution and verify that the problem is solved. After you identify the root because of the customer complaints, find a solution and send that solution to the customer. It is important to verify that the solution you propose actually solve the problems. There are a couple ways to do this. The first way is if you can verify that the solution is working at this line at the end of your communication. You can say, please let me know if there anything else I can do for you. I'm happy to help you. Or the second way is verify that the solution is working. Then reply with, I've tested this myself and it all appears to be working as expected. But please let me know that you're still running at this issue. In some cases, it is best to call the customer back after a few days have passed to make sure that everything is okay and being resolved. Or it could be you can monitor the feedback from the internet. If there are still negative feedback, it means there are some things that need more resolve again. And then for the last step is log complaints so you can track trends. If you had one complaint from one customer about the serious issue over the last 10 years, it probably doesn't need to be resolved. But if you receive a lot of message, a lot of customers who all share the same complaints, that is what needs to be resolved. To identify complaints, a system is needed that can track customer complaints so the team can capture and also monitor how often the problems occur repeatedly and then follow up on any problems.
Next is performance appraisal. What is performance appraisal? Performance appraisal is a process used by organizations to evaluate the job performance of their employees. It is a systematic evaluation of how well is an employee is performing their job to set the standards, expectations, and goals to their company. The process data often includes setting, providing regular feedback, and conducting formal review at specific intervals. Performance appraisal may be used to provide employee with constructive feedback. And next, performance appraisal objective. What is performance appraisal objective? It includes 5 items. 1. Providing feedback means of providing employee with feedback on their job performance, include where are they can increase their capability or where they can improvement their needs. 2. Identifying training and development needs. It means manager can identify areas where employees may need additional training or development opportunities to improve their job skills and performance. Number 3 is facilitating communication. It means a forum for employees and manager to discuss job performance, goals, expectations that can help to improve their community, communication, and understanding between them. 4. Motivating employees. What is motivating employees? That is recognize their achievement and providing a clear understanding of how their performance contributes to the organization's success. Last, making employment decision. It may be used to make decision about promotion, transfers, or termination based on the employee's job performance. So overall, performance appraisal objective is to help employee to improve their job, to enhance communication and feedback between employees and manager, and support decision making about employees related issues. Next, this is type of performance appraisal. Number 1 is traditional appraisal. This is a type of performance appraisal where the supervisor or manager evaluates the employee's performance based on specific criteria or standard that they set to the organization. Number 2 is second appraisal. This is the appraisal that involves the employee evaluating their own performance or self-improvement and providing feedback to the supervisor or manager. 3. Employees initiate review. In this type, performance appraisal, the employee initiates the review process and request feedback to the supervisor or manager. Last, 360-degree feedback. This is a comprehensive performance appraisal process that involves gathering feedback from the multiple source, including the internal source or external source. Next, our last topic is method of collecting data. There are two approaches of method of collecting data. The first one is past-oriented method. This is focused on the employee's past performance and achievement. It may be include method like graphic rating scales, critical incidents, and behaviorally anchored rating scales or BARS, and evaluate performance based on specific criteria or behavior demonstrated in the past. Lastly, future-oriented method. This method is collecting data and focus on the employee's potential for the future performance and development. It may be include method like management by objective or MBO, and there the employees and supervisors set specific goals and objectives for the future, and where employees participate in simulated work scenarios to evaluate their potential for future success in specific role or position. Next.
Success is not fatal. Final. Failure is not fatal. It is courage to continue that counts. Thank you very much for your great attention, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for your listening. May all those we have shared be beneficial for all of us. If anyone has any questions, I'll be happy to open up the discussions. And we will do our best to answer your question. Thank you.